Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And we're going to continue tonight in our series. And this time we're talking about unity. Unity / one mind / one body. And for the last two Thursday, we discussed in detail about unity. What unity is and what the expectation of God is concerning the church or his body. And tonight we're going to start talking about one mind. Praise the Lord. If you missed any of the teaching on unity, please go on YouTube and listen to them. It's very important.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
But one thing that I want us to remember very well tonight is that the pathway to unity is the Trinity. If you were here last Thursday, you know that we emphasized that and we expanded on it. The pathway to unity is Trinity. If we do not honor the Trinity, we cannot be united. And we saw the God gave us a very vivid illustration that is very easy to understand. God is the magnet. And when the magnet stands and you bring different nails close to the magnet, what happens? The nails get attached to the magnet and the nails get attached to themselves. So that was the illustration that God gave us. God is the magnet. If we don't come and attach ourselves to God, it becomes impossible for us to be united. Because if you pull out all the nails from the magnet and you put them on the table, they will all fall apart. But once the magnet is there, they all come together. So that's just the summary of the whole thing. Unity is from Trinity. So the pathway to unity is Trinity. As long as we all desire the same God and we all work towards the same goal, it becomes very easy for us to be united. We saw that unity must come from the Spirit. It must come from the Spirit. And we mentioned last Thursday that a lot of people try to unite together on the level of the soul, and a lot of damage happened because of that. Because the Bible says that where there is envy and strife, there is confusion and every evil thing. And we know where envy is from. It's from the soul. When soulish people gather together, there must be envy there. There must be strife. And that's why there's a lot of evil and a lot of destruction come from that. Praise the Lord. And we also emphasized last Thursday how the enemy tried to go around that. The enemy already know that that is bound to happen. So when people gather together like that in the world, Most of the time, those that come together in fraternity or cult or whatever, they will apportion punishment and say, okay, if you break the rule, this is the punishment that is going to be apportioned to you. That is why people comply. And even in spite of the punishment, people still do not comply and they suffer. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
But when we come to the house of the Lord, nobody dishes out any punishment. It's not the Spirit of God. If you find yourself somewhere where the additional punishment because you are not doing the right thing, you better run because the devil is there. Praise the Lord. And I know that we've gone over that over and over again, because if God operates like that, he wouldn't have eaten the fruit, because we know that it was possible for God to say, okay, Abe, as you are stretching your hand, I will cut the hand so you don't have to eat the fruit. God does not operate like that. God gives us a free will. He will tell us what to do and he will allow us to choose whether we want to do it or not. Praise the Lord. And when Jesus Christ came also, he did not force anybody to do the right thing. And that's why sometimes when he preaches the word, a lot of people will leave him, because he will say, look, this is the truth, take it or leave it. And some will leave, some will stay. Praise the Lord. And the same way God is still operating today, because it is the same Spirit. The Spirit of the Lord is here and is speaking to us every day, compelling us, telling us what we need to do. Now he's not going to force us. But it's going to compel us. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
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 So we know that it is possible to be united because it is one spirit. It is one Lord. It is one baptism. Because when we get born again, Christ came into us. So that is the spirit that we have. And if you have the spirit of Christ and I have the spirit of Christ, we are one already. We don't have to try to be one. But when the Christ is not there, that's where the problem is. Praise the Lord. So now we go further today and we talk about one mind. And I know that, you know, some people might be thinking in their mind right now, okay, why are we talking about one mind? Because I already said last Thursday that when we unite, we must unite in the spirit. We shouldn't unite in our soul. So why are we talking about one mind? Because then it looks like we're contradicting ourselves, but really it's not a contradiction. And when we go through the word of God and we understand why we need to have one mind. But the point is, before we can have one mind, we must first of all be united in the spirit. If we don't have one spirit, we cannot have one mind. If we don't have one spirit, we cannot have one mind. The one spirit is the primary thing, and then the one mind we follow. And I will let you know the reason why we need the one mind. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Our text tonight is going to be taken from Philippians chapter 1, verse 27. That's our text. Only one verse. I'm going to read it. It says, only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ, that whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affair, that ye stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. Praise the Lord. This is the letter that Paul wrote to the Philippians, and he was telling them, he said, look, don't do eye service. You know, some people do that. You say, when I'm coming, everybody is acting right. When I'm not there, you're not acting right. He said, don't do that. He said, but one thing that I want to always hear from this church is that you all stand together. Fast in what? One spirit. And I want us to underline that there, because before Paul talked about mind, he's talked about spirit. And that was what I was trying to explain to you. There must be one spirit first before there is one mind. He said, stand fast in one spirit with one mind, striving together. That is, we have one goal. We are striving together for the faith of the gospel. That is what we have in common. That's why we are one. Because of a kingdom that is different from the kingdom of this world. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. The Amplified Version says, let me hear about you that you are standing firm in one spirit, that is, having one purpose, with one mind, striving side by side, as if you are in a combat for the faith of the gospel. Look, we are in an army. We have been enlisted in an army. Let's begin to act like that. Have you ever seen some army that are, some battalion, let's put it that way, they dispatch them to go and do a war, and then some of them will say, this is what we will do. And the other one will say, have you ever seen that before? When they do that, they've already been defeated. The battalion works together, whether they like themselves or not, because they work towards one goal. And that is what matters. Praise the Lord. So we're talking about one goal right now, the gospel of Christ, the kingdom of God. We must stand together in unity, because that is what our goal is. Praise the Lord. So it's one spirit, it's one purpose. We're in combat, fighting for the gospel of God. Praise the Lord. Now, let me go back a little bit and try to explain to you who we are as a man and why we need one mind. Why one spirit is not enough. Why is it not enough for us to just be united in the spirit? You understand what I'm saying? We are spirit. We always tell ourselves that. For the past few weeks, now we confess it. Say it again. I'm a spirit.
I'm a spirit.
I'm a spirit.
I'm a spirit.
Tell your neighbor you are a spirit.
You are a spirit.
That's who you are. Whether you want to believe it or not, because one day this body suit is going to disappear. I mean, it's just like I go home right now, I change from this dress to another one. That's the way our body is. One day we will change that body to something else. But one thing that we abide is our spirit. But the point is, as long as we are still here on earth, we still need our mind. And that is where I want to go to explain to you so that you will understand why we need one mind. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So we know that a human being is made up of the spirit, the soul, and the body. And we know that our soul is also made of three components: our mind, our will, and our emotion. If we like, we can write that down, but that's very important. A man is made up of a spirit, soul, and body. And then your soul is made up of your will, your mind, and your emotion. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Now, when God created man, the Bible says he breathed into man, and man became a living soul. As of that time, man has a spirit. That's where our spirit came from God. So man was a spirit and a soul and a body. The body of man connects man to the earth. And the spirit of man connects man to God. Let me tell you something. There is no way a spirit can operate on earth without a body. You understand what I'm saying? Anyway, some people don't believe the stories that people tell, you know, when those that have near-death experience. I tend to believe them. Some people may be lying. and I become born again. But then what about my soul? So now we have a man, you have a spirit, you have your soul, you have your body. Your spirit is born again, I mean, is the spirit of Christ. But then your soul is being contaminated. And that's the soul that has been active since when we were born. A lot of things have been done in our soul. So, that soul needs to be renewed also. So that's where I'm going. And except our soul is renewed, we cannot have one mind. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
If our soul is not renewed, we cannot have one mind. So let's just keep that in our hand as we continue and we continue to expose the Word of God to see what the Lord have to tell us to do. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I want us to read Galatians chapter 5. From verse 16 to 18. Galatians chapter 5. I know those who were here last Thursday, you will remember that we ended off with reading Galatians chapter 5 last Thursday. So we're starting again from that place tonight. Verse 16 says, "This I say, then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. But if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law." Praise the Lord. So what was Paul saying here? He says, the flesh lusted against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. We have the Spirit of Christ. Our spirit wants to act like Christ. But the Bible says our flesh wants to do something else. Why? Because of the soul. Our soul and our flesh have been acting together in cooperation all these years before we gave our life to Christ. You understand what I'm saying? Now you say you are a Christian. You have the Spirit of Christ. And that Spirit now wants to be telling the flesh to do something else. The soul is saying, I've been here
before you
came. This is what we will do. And then you begin to fight against yourself. Your spirit man is telling you don't do it. Your soul is saying that's what you will do. And unfortunately, most of us will yield. So because our soul is, that's why our spirit man needs to be built up. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Because if the spirit is a baby, it's not a fair game. You understand? Because even when they match people together in fights, let's say boxers or wrestlers, they check their weight and their height. And they match them according to their build. But you know what is happening? Our soul that is already so muscular and strong now is pitched against a spirit man that is a baby. So who is going to win? That's why most Christians are carnal. I mean, they are born again. They have the spirit of Christ. The spirit is a baby. So their soul wins all the time. They do anything they want to do. So you look at some people and say, how can this person be a Christian? Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
As long as we still operate like that, we cannot have one mind. We cannot. Tell your neighbor, grow up.
Grow up.
Grow up.
Grow up.
Our spirit man needs to grow up. Praise the Lord. Yes, we can say that too. Our spirit man needs to grow up.
Our spirit man needs to grow up.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Because our mind must be renewed. Our mind must be renewed. We must cast away this soul that has been contaminated. That's why the Bible says, put it off. put it off like a coat, throw it away. But how will you put it off when it's so attached to you? The only way that can be done is when our spirit is built up. Praise the Lord. And then if we continue to read further in the book of Galatians, you will see all the works of the flesh that is listed there. All the works of the flesh. We already read that last Thursday, so I'm not going to go through it. We can read it when we get home. Praise the Lord. But the point is that our mind must be renewed so that we can be on the same page with our spirit. Praise the Lord. When a Christian grew up to a point in your life where when your spirit is speaking something, your mind is speaking the same thing, you are at a point where you will always have things right in your life. I mean, your spirit is saying one thing and your mind agrees with it. Was it not what happened to Peter, James, and John when they were in the Garden of Gethsemane? And Jesus told them, watch with me. Their spirit wanted to pray, but their flesh couldn't, because Mr. Saul had been so much grown up and their spirit could not battle with it. And some of us still quote that scripture today, even though I know I've preached it here before. Never quote that scripture in your life, because it's not for your good. Never say the spirit is willing and the flesh is weak. Because like I said, it is not everything that is written in the Bible that you need to appropriate for yourself. Some of them are written to warn you. Praise the Lord. Because nobody wants to quote Job. Do you understand? And appropriate it to yourself. Nobody wants to do it. Nobody wants to say, what that which thou doest, go do it quickly. Eh? When Judas was thinking to go and hang himself. So don't quote the Bible that says the spirit is willing and the flesh is weak, because it was written there for us to know that it ought not to be so. It ought not to be so. When your spirit is willing and your flesh is weak, you have a problem. Do you understand? When a believer says, my spirit is willing but my flesh is weak, right there and then you have a problem. Because it means that your soul is stronger than your spirit, and you are a soulish Christian and you are a carnal Christian. And we all know what the Bible says about carnal Christian. That's why things don't work out. And then we blame God. But please don't blame God. Because we are the people that is standing against ourselves. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I want us to read Romans chapter 12, verse 1 to 2. Romans 12, 1 to 2. It says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what that which is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Brethren, it is our own duty to present our bodies. God has already done his own. There was no way that we could reconnect ourselves back to God. There was no way that we could revive our own spirit. There was no way that we could make ourselves born again. The Bible says, he that is born of the Spirit is of the Spirit. God did that part. We are born again and we have the Spirit of God. But God now gives us the mandate to present our soul and our flesh to be acceptable before him. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
And that is what we need to work on. Because that one does not come automatically. It does not come by you wishing. It does not come by how long you have been in Christ. And I'm going to say that again. It does not come by how long you have been in Christ. You might have been born again for 30 years. If you do not do what you need to do to grow, you stay a baby. And that's why when Paul wrote a lot of letters that he wrote, he chastised the people. He said, why are you still as babies when you're supposed to be grown up already? Because they did not do what they need to do. And because they did not do what they need to do, they have not changed. Praise the Lord. But in this house, we do what we need to do. In the name of Jesus. In this house, we will do what we need to do. In the name of Jesus. Nobody remain as baby in the Lord. Because nobody give birth to babies here and want them to stay like that. A lot of us gave birth to babies years and years ago. When you look at them today, they are no longer babies. God forbid, if somebody have a baby 20 years ago and you look at the baby and it's still the same, that is bad news. That is an imbecile that is useless to himself, useless to the family, useless to you, the parents. Because you have to continue to take care of that baby for the rest of the baby's life. That's what we're talking about. When we come to the body of Christ, and you are born into the body of Christ, and you refuse to grow, you become a liability. You're no good for yourself. You're no good for God. You're no good for the rest of the body. And that's why this teaching is going on now. Because when we have somebody like that in the house, they affect everybody. I mean, that's just the truth. If there's a family that is dealing with that, you know that it affects everybody. But why do we want to live like that when there's a solution to it? And that's why the teaching is going out. Praise the Lord. For us to be able to operate as one mind, we must all grow up. We must all renew our mind. Because when we renew our mind, we are not renew our mind by ourselves. We are renew our mind by the Spirit of the Lord, which is the same Spirit that we're talking about. Praise the Lord. So if you sit there and you renew your mind with the same Spirit, and you sit there and you renew your mind with the same Spirit, is it not the same Spirit? Will we not be one? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We don't have to force it. It happens automatically. Praise the Lord. And I'm going to read Romans 12 again. I want to read some other translations. Praise the Lord. The Message Bible says, so here is what I want you to do. God helping you. Take your everyday ordinary life, your sleep, eating, going to work, walking around life, and place it before God as an offering. We are not Christians only when we come to church. Because if our mind is not renewed, that is what we will be. You will only be a Christian when we come to church. Because when you are out there, you act as the unbelievers act. Because your mind and your soul will make you to react. Your emotion will react the way somebody that is not born again will react. Because your mind has not been renewed. Praise the Lord. So our mind has to be renewed. The expanded version, verse 2 says, do not be shaped or conformed or pressed into the mold of this world. Instead, be changed within. Be transformed within by a new way of thinking. A new way of thinking. What is that new way of thinking? The way Christ thinks. The way Christ thinks. And things is getting worse in the church right now because people have become, they are conforming to the world. Let's do it the way the world do it. But we cannot do that. Because we must do it the way Christ does it. Our soul is no longer supposed to wander around and be subject to the devil anymore. Because now that our spirit man have been born again, our soul is supposed to be subject to our spirit. So when God speaks to us through our spirit, our soul needs to agree. Praise the Lord. You know that God communicates with us through our spirit. And that's why it's difficult for most of us to hear God. A lot of us have problem hearing God. I mean, when we talk about God instructing you, God talking to you, you'll be wondering, okay, how will I know when God is telling me something? Why do we feel like that? Because our soul is too alive. We have not renewed our mind. Our soul is so active that when our spirit is speaking, we cannot hear. Too much noise going on. We need to build up our spirit man, because it is your spirit man that will help you to put off that old man and will help you have the mind of Christ. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And I want to tell you something. God is still speaking. In fact, God is a speaking spirit. Say it to your neighbor.
God is
a speaking spirit. One characteristic of God is that he speaks. He speaks continuously. And that's why the Bible says we are speaking spirits. We are speaking spirits because God created us in his own image. But unfortunately, we are not speaking what God created us to be speaking. We are using our mind or our mouth to say the things that our unregenerated mind is telling us to say. And because of that, we have bad results in our life. There's power in your mouth. And I know that if you go back to the teaching that we did at the beginning, we talked about that. There is power in the mouth of a man, particularly a man whose spirit has been renewed. Because remember, when your spirit is renewed and your spirit is connected to your body and you begin to speak out what is in your spirit, you want to start to create. But when the soul between your spirit and your body is contaminated, it becomes very difficult for your body to yield to your spirit. And that's what we're talking about today. Our soul limits us. It limits us. There is a limitation that is placed on a carnal Christian. And this is not only for the good of other people or for the good of the church, is for your own good. Because if we don't deal with it, we just cannot get close to God. But God is going to help us.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So what is the summary of what we're talking about today? The summary is that when it comes to the spirit, when it comes to our spirit, the new spirits we have in us, we didn't work for it. It's a gift, it's the grace of God. You ask for it, you receive it by faith, you have it. But if you must have a new mind, there is something that you have to do. You have something that you need to do for you to have a new mind. And that is where a lot of us get stuck. A lot of Christians. We don't want to put in anything. We do not want to put in anything to get ourselves to grow. We need to break off of that bondage. Because I know that that is also a bondage of the enemy. And we'll start to add that to our Monday's prayer. We need to break off of the bondage that the enemy has put upon us, not to want to put any input to our spiritual growth. I know all the people that are seated here today, we are very hardworking people. I know that. I know how much hard work that we put in into our school. Let's just even talk about school alumni right now. You go to school, you must graduate. How much work do you put to it? And that is just for you to get physical, something physical that have no eternal value. But yet, we don't want to put any work to make our spirit man to grow. We must work. I mean, that is it. If I stand here this evening and tell you, just put in the minimum or just do your best, I'll be lying to you. You must work. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So if you want your mind to be renewed, your mind to be the mind of Christ, you must participate in something that needs to be done to bring it to pass. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want us to read Ephesians chapter 4. From verse 17. He says, "This I say therefore, and testify in the Lord, that ye henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk in the vanity of their mind." Paul was talking to Christians. He says, you should not walk in the vanity of your mind like people that didn't even know God. Because that's what was going on in the church at that time. Look at verse 18. "Having the understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God through the ignorance that is in them because of the blindness of their eyes." He's talking about the unbelievers. That's the situation of the unbelievers. They have been blinded. He said, you are not supposed to walk like that. 19. "Who, being past feeling, have given themselves over unto lasciviousness to walk all uncleanness with greediness." Now look at verse 20. It says, "But ye have not so learned Christ." That is not who Christ is. "If so be that ye have heard him and have been taught by him as the truth is in Jesus." Now look at verse 22. "That ye put off concerning the former conversation the old man." It is our duty to put the old man off of us. God is not going to do it for us. We need to put off the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust. Our old man is corrupt. Our old mind, our soul is corrupt. We need to put it off. Now look at verse 23. It says, "And be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that ye put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness." We need to put on the new man. We need to put on the new man. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 to 10. Colossians chapter 3. It says, "If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ seated on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above and not on the things of the earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory." Now look at verse 5. "Mortify therefore your members which are on the earth." Mortify your members. It is your duty. It is your duty to mortify your members. Yes, your spirit is born again, but it is your duty to mortify your members. And then he listed some things: fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscences, covetousness, which is idolatry. "For which things sake the wrath of God cometh on the children of his disobedience." Verse 7. "In which ye also walked sometime when ye lived in them." We walked like that before. Now that we have a new spirit, why should we walk the same way again? But now ye also put off all these things, anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. Lie not one to the other, seeing that ye have put off the old man with his deed. Verse 10. And have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. Our mind must be renewed. And the renewal of our mind is done by us. God will not do it for us. It is an effort that we need to do. And we have to do it daily. And we have to commit it. We need to be committed to it. To do it. And then when we do it, our mind will be the mind of Christ. It will be very, very easy for us to do the will of God. Because when God instructs you, your mind agrees with it. You don't need to fight it anymore. And then you just do it. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
James chapter 1, verse 21 to 25. James chapter 1. It says, wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of nothingness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save what?
So,
hallelujah. He says, receive the engrafted word, which is able to save your souls. Your souls. Yes. We are born again. We have a new spirit. Our soul needs to be harnessed. We need to harness our soul from the grip of the enemy. We need to save our soul from the contamination of the world and the contamination of the evil one. We need to have a new mind. And the new mind that we want to have is that of Christ. And how can we have it? The word of God. That's where we're coming back to. And as I always say, every teaching we have in this church, always take us back to the word of God. Always take us back to the word of God. Praise the Lord. That is the way our soul can be saved. Now look at verse 22. Be ye doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own self. For if any be a hearer of the word and not doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. For if he beholded himself and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continue therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deeds. Praise the Lord. That's the way of blessing right there. The way of blessing. The way of blessing. This man shall be blessed in his deeds. The word of God is able to save our soul. Is able to save our soul. We need our soul also. We need our soul. Because our body is still here on the earth. If God must use you, you need your soul to be renewed. Your mind to be renewed. And your mind can only be renewed by the word of God. And somebody may sit here and say, okay, I don't want God to use me. Yes, because I said, if you want God to use you. But the point is that if you want blessings, because that's what we're all seeking. We're seeking for all these things from God. But we can't get them from God except we can connect with him. And yes, it is our spirit that connects with God. But when your spirit connects with God, your mind must be in agreement with your spirit. Otherwise, you will not do what your spirit is telling you to do. Because that is when you will find yourself in a situation where the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. But the flesh does not need to be weak if your mind is renewed. And the mind can only be renewed with the word of God. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So the important thing is, as we come together in one spirit, we are one in the spirit. We also must work towards being one in the mind. Otherwise, there will still be room for the enemy to come and cause hindrances Do you understand what I'm saying? And I will say that again. We have unity of spirit. It is imperative also for us to be united in our mind. Because if we do not unite in our mind, the enemy has a loophole to come, to hinder, to prevent, and cause some bad thing to happen. Because the person whose mind is not united, we bring a discord.
Yeah.
We bring a discord. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And our mind cannot be united except we have the mind of Christ. Because let me tell you something. It does not matter how spiritual I am. I still have, my mind is different from your mind. You understand what I'm saying? Your mind is different from my mind. But the only mind that can be the same is the mind of Christ. So if I put on the mind of Christ, you put on the mind of Christ, you put on the mind of Christ, and we all put on the mind of Christ, and we come together, then we have one mind. And if we have built up our spirit man strong enough, all of us, to the point where even if the enemy is trying to come through our mind, because we always try to come, it happens to Jesus Christ. When he was here, the enemy tried to come through his mind. If you are the Son of God, make this stone to be bread. But the spirit man rose up and said, look, it is written. But if our spirit man has been built up, we will be able to at that time rise up and overcome what is trying to come through the carnal mind and put it into its place. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
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 Thank you, Jesus. Philippians chapter 2, verse 2. It says, make my joy complete by being of the same mind, having the same love towards one another, knit together in spirit, intent and on purpose, and living a life that reflects your faith and spread the gospel, the good news regarding salvation through the faith in Christ. Praise the Lord. And you will see that here, when Paul was talking about unity in the mind, he also put in there unity in the spirit. It is not possible to have a united mind without a united spirit. It starts from a united spirit, but we must work on a united mind by transforming our mind to the mind of Christ, putting on Christ. And the only way we can put on Christ is the word of God. Praise the Lord. There is no other way. Look, if you don't want to study the Bible, you are cheating yourself. If you don't have time, because that's the problem we have, we put it all on time. Oh, yes, I want to study the Bible, but there's no time. Look, if there's no time, what you are saying is that you don't have time to collect your blessing. You don't have time to get blessings from God. You don't have time for God to help you. So, and then if those things don't come, please don't blame God. We have time for everything. When your boss tells you at work, you must be at work between so hour. If you are not there, you will not get paid salary. You know to do it. When you go to a doctor and they say, take this medicine, even if they tell you every hour, you will find time to go and take that medicine every hour. You understand? We find a way to obey the instruction that the world tells us to do. But when God tells us to do something, we don't have time for it. The word of God. That is where everything is tied, brethren. We cannot get around the word of God. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
2 Corinthians 13:11. Praise the Lord. It says, finally, brethren, farewell. Be perfect. Be of good comfort. Be of one mind. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace shall be with you. That's another prayer. Or the farewell blessing that Paul was giving to the people. He says, be of one mind. It is very, very important for us to be of one mind. And we cannot be of one mind without our mind being renewed. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And finally, I want to read a scripture, which is very common, but I want to go over it. The importance of the Word of God cannot be overemphasized. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
John chapter 1. Jesus Christ is the Word. It's Him. It is this Word that will renew our mind. God already has given us His Spirit. Jesus already gave His life for us. And this life He gave to us. Don't let us sabotage the life that God has given us. Because the price that was paid for it is too much. You understand what I'm saying? If you are the one that paid so much for something, you will do everything to make it work. Do you understand? Do you know what people do to make a business work when they put a lot of investment into it? They've invested so much in the company, they don't want the company to go down. They do everything that they need to do. So why are we treating the life of Jesus Christ as if it doesn't worth anything? If God have to sacrifice His only Son to save us, what is it that we cannot sacrifice to make sure that we get the best out of this that God has given to us? And whatever is being taught here tonight is not only for the benefit of the body in the world, but even your own personal benefit. Because when you have the mind of Christ, apart from the fact that He helps us to have one mind, to be in unity, for God to do what He wants to do in our midst and in the world, also, He helps you. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
John chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him. And without Him was not anything made that was made. And in Him was life. And the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. And the same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, which lighteneth every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of flesh, nor of the will of a man, but of God. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And this is the nutshell of what we've been talking about for a few Thursdays right now. He is the one that lightens every man that comes to the world. Born not of the will of a man, not of sperms and blood. And it is this life that He gave to us. Free. But then when we carry this life about in this body that is still connected with the uncircumcised soul, how can we reap the benefits of it? Do you understand what I'm saying? And the only thing that God is asking us to do is renew your mind. Renew your mind. And he also gave us the tool. You know, it's a different thing when God said, renew your mind anyhow, just do it. And then you are racking your head. What am I going to do? He gave you the tool, the word. The word is a spirit. It's functional, it's active, it's alive. We don't know how he does it, but he does it. You just need to read it and meditate on it. And he will rid you of all this carnality and contamination, so that your soul can also be free. And then when your soul is free, then your spirit can manifest and express itself through you fully and completely. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to stop here today. And I know that the Spirit of God will give us understanding.
Amen.
We can go on YouTube and listen to this message over and over and over again. But we can never overemphasize the Word of God. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Let's stand on our feet.